Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching India's World with me, Frank Rousen Pereira. 6 months after the ousting of the Maldives pro-China president Abdulla Yameen, India has resumed its work of installing a chain of radars on the islands that will link up with the existing naval radar chain in India to provide live feed. The islands of Maldives, located some 700 kilometers southwest of Kerala, are an important part of the seagoing traffic monitoring system that India is building. India is to set up 10 coastal surveillance radars made by public sector giant Bharat Electronics Limited. Currently, phase 2 of the coastal surveillance radar project is underway, during which 7 radar stations are being installed and 3 existing radar stations of phase 1 are being upgraded. India is setting up the chain of radars to link it up with the 46 coastal surveillance radars installed all along its 7,519-kilometer coast. Sri Lanka will host 6 radars, Mauritius 8, Seychelles 1, and Maldives will have 10. These will present comprehensive live feed of ship movements in the Indian Ocean region. This feed will then be used by the Indian Navy and its allies. On this edition of India's World, we will analyse India's radar system in the Maldives and the Indian Ocean region. Joining me on the programme today are Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinha, retired defence expert, Prabhudayal, former ambassador, and Professor Harshvi Pant, Head Strategic Studies Observer Research Foundation. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of India's World. Admiral, I'd like to begin the program with you. Tell us more about the coastal surveillance radar chain.
Frank, after the 26/11, we realized that our coastal surveillance required a lot of tweaking up. And under that CCS paper, the first set of 46 radars were approved. All those radars are in place now along the Indian coastline that you mentioned, 7,500. Subsequently, there is an fusion center where all the picture actually gets into the, into a big database. And the feed also comes from our aircraft, our ships and submarines who are patrolling in various parts of the Indian Ocean. And all that feed is synthesized together in the fusion center. And it is passed on to the commands, who will actually take an action in case of any requirement to intervene. After that, we have also had a agreement with these countries that you mentioned, Sri Lanka, Maldives, Seychelles, and Mauritius, that you're too close in the ocean to these countries, and therefore, if we can pick up a hostile target or a target which is likely to do some create some trouble, then you got to know, and it is good for them as well. And as you know, the Prime Minister's security and growth for all in the region. So, as a net security provider, we thought it is necessary to get these people on board. Under that scheme, the number of radars that you talked about are Sri Lanka has got all the radars. Maldives, we have got a defense action plan. Unfortunately, as you know, in the previous regime, the action plan did not get into much action, and the previous president, he put a stop on the the getting the radar on, and therefore the first 3 radars which were put, even they were not complete because they could not pick up the automatic identification system in the feed. So that is being done by Bell now, and 7 more is going to be put. And they will be actually transported to the central hub, which is in Manesar, and to all the commands, and to the country and Maldives, through a leased line, through a satellite, to the central position. So that's going to give a very good maritime domain awareness in the entire Indian Ocean, and we will be better informed, we will be better prepared. And hopefully, it will help us in preventing another Mumbai type of attack.
Okay, all right. Ambassador, I'd like to bring you into the picture now. How have things changed over the last 6 months in the Maldives for us to actually go ahead and restart this radar system program?
Well, the restarting of this radar system in the Maldives shows how dramatically a change of government in any of our neighboring countries can bring about a sea change in their policy towards India. The radar system had been stalled because of the policy of the Abdulla Yameen government. He had bent over backwards to accommodate the Chinese while crushing democracy at home. And he had paid scant regard to India's concerns, even to the extent that he had placed visa restrictions on Indian passport holders, put curbs on the meeting of Indian diplomats with the officials of the Maldives, and demanded that the Indian helicopters and their crew be taken out of the Maldives. So he had taken things to a ridiculous extreme. And the crushing blow which he suffered in the last 6 months during the election process shows how the people of Maldives were disenchanted with him. He lost in the September election to President Soli, now the president. And earlier this month, his party was routed in the parliamentary elections, and the Maldivian Democratic Party got 76% of the seats. So it shows how policies needed to be changed, and the fact that this was amply recognized by the Maldivian people was evident from the outcome of the results. And since his election, President Soli has tried to put things back on track. He has visited India in December and stated very clearly that he wants a close relationship with India, and has indicated that he would pay full regard to our security concerns, which is why their defense minister, who, like our own defense minister, is a lady, visited India and made it amply clear that the Maldives were going to be fully cognizant of our security needs and our requirements. We, on our part, have pledged developmental assistance, which is intended to take the Maldives out from the debt trap in which they were finding themselves.
Right.
At the same time, I want to point out that the setting up of the coastal radar security system, a surveillance system, indicates how Prime Minister Modi's government has been pursuing a policy of challenging China's growing role in our region. If you recall, in September 2015, or thereabouts, Prime Minister Modi visited Sri Lanka, he visited Mauritius and the Seychelles, and promoted the policy of security and growth for all in the region. And the coastal radar surveillance system is an integral part of that policy.
Right.
The Maldives had held back. We had been able to install 6 coastal radars in Sri Lanka, 8 in Mauritius and 1 in Seychelles. But because of the policies of Abdulla Yameen, he had held back. And now that is going to be corrected, because if the 10 radars are in place, then India's ability to monitor the traffic of ships in the Indian Ocean region, which is very fundamental for our security, because our coastline is 7,519 kilometers long.
Yeah.
And as the Admiral mentioned, the attack on Mumbai, the Mumbai terror attack, was carried out by sea.
Sure.
And this enhanced surveillance system will be able to monitor the movement of even small boats.
Right.
So such incidents like the Mumbai terror attack can be prevented. In addition, I want to also mention that China's project of the One Belt, One Road has been impacting on our security. China has set up projects in Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh. Of course, these countries have begun to have second thoughts. Pakistan has found itself in a big debt trap.
Right.
Sri Lanka had to put out the Hambantota port on a lease to China to pay back the money that it owed. So India has been emerging as another alternative, as an alternative model. And in that sense, the recognition by the Maldives of the importance and value of India in their development stands out, and their decision to restart the project of putting the coastal surveillance radars in the Maldives is very, very significant.
Absolutely. All right. Professor, I'd like to bring you in now. You know, so how does this radar system really help India, and more importantly, the Maldives too?
Well, I think there are a number of issues on the table. You know, if you see the evolution of this project itself, started off primarily looking at the non-state threat that India was facing in the region, in the maritime domain. But I think it has grown into a project that is now about the larger issues of structural change in the region. It is about maritime domain awareness. It is about the potential role that India can play in the Indian Ocean region. And I think if you bring them all together, you get a picture of India trying to emerge as a net security provider in the Indian Ocean region, and also trying to look at some of these important, you know, island nations around India's periphery as important partners in that endeavor. So it is not simply that you know, we want to enhance our preventive mechanisms vis-a-vis the non-state actors, but there is another dimension of state actors in Indian Ocean region is becoming extremely contested. It is very important for India, being the pivotal power in the region, to have the kind of maritime domain awareness that will allow us to safeguard our interests, as well as allow that contestation from not reaching proportions where it manifests itself in conflictual ways. So you have an entirely new dimension here, where India's role as a preeminent power in the region becomes very important, not only for itself, but also for these smaller countries. And that is what we have seen in terms of the evolution of the project, that it has grown from a project that India was primarily interested in for itself, for preventing 2611 kind of attacks, to a project which is now about, as has been pointed out, Prime Minister says, growth and security for all in the region. And therefore, I think it allows India to project itself as a benign actor in the region, as an actor that is a responsible stakeholder in managing the sea lanes. And of course, there is the economic and trade dimension, which enhances not only India's capacities, but also allows India to work and to help other countries, which are also equally dependent on waterways, on the maritime space. And we know that maritime space is becoming very, very contested. There are powers who have challenged our global norms, global narratives on how the maritime space is to be governed. So I think India is sending out multiple messages to multiple stakeholders, and it is to be hoped that these messages, given that now Maldives has come back to us, if you will, in a way that we were not envisioning a few months back, it allows, I think, India to make a case that, look, we are now a responsible actor, and the other states in the region are recognizing our importance, our role as a benign actor. So perhaps as a partnership with these actors, what can we do, both for security as well as for economic development? And I think that's a larger message, which is a very important message, but also I think a very productive message emanating from New Delhi, and that there can be other powers who can be primarily interested in strategic matters, but we are also here for something else. We are also here for the growth and economic development of our regional partners.
Right.
And I think that's a message that perhaps this the system, though it has a strategic imprint, but it also is sending out a larger message about India's partnership role in the region.
Absolutely. So that having been said, Admiral, so talking about the other powers that lie in the region, is the radar system being completed with an eye on China? Is this really a counter to China's ambitions in the region?
Well, if you see the Indian state and their bilateral agreements with these countries in the IOR, this is quite old. It has been there even before China became a sort of contesting power in this part of the world. But it has only, all these bilateral relations which have been, the agreements which have been signed, they are now being put into with full force now that the Chinese have emerged here. Because we always thought that we had a fair amount of independence of operating in the Indian Ocean. But now it is slowly being challenged by China. Therefore, if you see even this, the Maldives Defense Pact, it was signed on 11 July 2018. I think Mr. Yameen was still the president at that time, but it was not acted upon because it caters for development of ports, participating in supplying equipment, weapons, and maybe participation of theirs in making India projects here, which we will make ourselves. So I think it is a larger bilateral relation, and what, as Professor Harsh was saying, that it is a big message. And China is not going to sit idle. I mean, I'm expecting that within a few days, the Chinese, action in the Maldives, because right now they have been taken aback. One is here and one is in Sabang. And the Global Times did make a mention after the Sabang, the agreement was signed, that India must not, by their presence, they might start taking, a little bit of contestation or maybe conflict with the Chinese, which is not good for them. They should remain where they are. So these kind of things have been worrying them. And I think this is a big shock, that the work has started. And if you see the extent of these radar stations, Frank, it is nearly from 5 degrees above equator to about 2 degrees below the equator. So in Gan Island, where we have our little bit of presence of technical team for looking after the boats. So I think that the areas that it will cover, Chinese need to be concerned and worried. But at the same time, we have already got agreements with France and with, US and Japan. They also have interest in the Indian Ocean region, and they would be quite satisfied, and they would actually come close to India's actions, because it also takes care of their maritime security in the region, and all of them are democratic countries.
Sure. That having been said, I want to take this point forward, Ambassador. So who are all the players really in the region, and what's at stake for them?
Well, China's policy in the Indian Ocean and Pacific region has caused concern to many countries, including the United States, Australia, New Zealand, the countries of Southeast Asia, and Japan, as well as Korea. So there have been indications by many of these countries to work more closely with India in regard to ensuring everybody's maritime security, and as well as securing the safety of the maritime routes. Now, as regards the Maldives, there are vital sea lanes passing through that. And these sea lanes are of interest to most countries which have trade going through this particular area. Now, as regards the Maldives, they are a small country and hence vulnerable. They were falling prey to the Chinese policy of largesse of a dubious nature. Now, the task of the present government and of all well-intentioned friends of the Maldives would be to help it pull out from that, and by promising an aid package of $1.4 billion, our government has indicated that it will do everything possible to help the Maldives to pursue their development and programs. Of course, the Maldives are not pulling away entirely from the Chinese. Let's not be under that illusion, because President Soli said that he would like to strengthen old friendships while developing new ones. Fair enough. But the possibility of their falling into the sort of trap which the Chinese are well known to lay for smaller countries gets reduced if India, as well as the other countries which have an interest in the sea lanes of this region, play a more proactive role.
Right.
I would also like to mention that the recent events in Sri Lanka, where several terrorist attacks were carried out, also raises the possibility of dangers to a small island nation like the Maldives. And their intelligence sharing with the government of the Maldives would be very, very important. And this radar system, the coastal surveillance radar system, would help not only us, but also the government of Maldives.
Right.
Because we would be able to get intelligence which we could share with the Maldives and prevent any terror attacks from happening.
So
I personally think that given the size of the Maldives, they need the assistance from us very, very strongly. And I think President Soli is fully cognizant of that.
Right. All right, Professor. So, how have the dynamics in the region changed since the elections in the Maldives in 2018?
Well, I think very significantly, because Maldives, it represents, the shift in Maldives represents something which perhaps, as was being pointed out earlier, Chinese have taken note of, that there is a discontent about the way Chinese operate. And that we have seen in country after country after country now. And what seems to be happening now is China is becoming an important and integral part of the domestic political narratives in these countries. And I think that's an interesting development over the last few years that we are seeing. And this is true of bigger countries like Australia, where China is figuring out in such a big way in terms of the domestic politics that, is shaping up and the kind of conversations they are having in, given the elections. And it was true of, you know, Sri Lanka. It has been true of Maldives, which I think should worry the Chinese, because you know, a lot of the times India has been that country in South Asia, for example, that we are so close to the Nepalese, to the you know, Sri Lankans, that we become part of the domestic political narrative, and that has not always been conducive to Indian interests. Often you get you know, a part of the domestic political contestation, and that prevents India from pursuing its interests. I think now with the Chinese and with the way they have manipulated the economics of these smaller countries, you see these divisions becoming very sharp. So you always have pro-China parties and you have anti-China parties, and at least the opposition, and that contestation is now becoming part of the domestic political systems. And so Maldives represented that shift, and I think the sense that smaller states in the Indian Ocean and in the wider Indo-Pacific are now operating with a greater degree of urgency and with a sense of agency that we thought they did not have earlier. We always thought these are big powers like China and others, they will control the domestic politics, but that is not happening. And they are taking very decisions, very pragmatic decisions based on what is in their interest. So the moment there is a realization that, look, we are falling into a debt trap, that the Chinese have not been fair with us, that there is a lack of transparency and unilateralism in Chinese behavior, there has been a shift in the domestic political, a corrective in the domestic political system. And I think that brings India's role to greater prominence, because India has always said that we are with the smaller states. We don't want to control your economy. What we want to make sure is that there is a fair, there is a degree of fairness in the way you operate, in the way you make laws, in the way you give out investment, make investment decisions. And I think that balance, when you create that balance, you will always find that India becomes a beneficiary, primarily because India is such an open democracy that almost all the decisions India takes in foreign policy are out in the open, whereas the Chinese modus operandi is often not clear to most of these countries. So I think what we are now looking at is a certain democratization of Chinese behavior in these around India's periphery, especially in the Indian Ocean region. And I think this will have consequences both for Chinese behavior, and I think this, the recent BRI forum that happened, it was very categorical, because you had the Chinese president in fact addressing these concerns. He was forced, he was on the back foot, saying that, look, these are problems, we have to be more transparent.
Right.
So clearly what India has been all along saying on these matters has been right, because if you look at India's record on BRI and in India's statement on BRI, that was very categorical, that this is unilateral and lacks transparency. And I think some of those things are now coming out in the open. And I think with that, the smaller states in India's periphery attain greater degree of agency. And I think that's good for India, that's good for Indian Ocean region, and that's good for those smaller states, because I think that allows them that freedom of choice that initially we thought they did not have.
All right. Quick closing comments now from all my guests. Coming back to the radar system, Admiral. So, you know, what is the kind of radars that we're going to have? You know, how sophisticated is it really going to be? What is the kind of live feed that we're going to get back?
Let me tell you the live feed of the radars as to what are we looking at. You know, it was just mentioned that there has been IS penetration in Sri Lanka. And you would recall that the Maldives had the highest density of people joining the IS. And we often tend to forget that we have a big security concern there, because the Maldives' northernmost island is only 90 nautical miles from the Minicoy Island, which is 162 kilometers. And those IS penetration, it is not impossible for them to get into Minicoy. And therefore, the radar systems will be able to see very long distances, and they would be able to transfer the images. In fact, there's going to be video cameras, and all those images will be transported onto the satellite systems through which it will be downlinked to the central server, and it will be available for all these countries, including our own commands who are supposed to take action. It will be in front of them. And if there are any unexpected movements, you know, the search or surveillance can be mounted, and maybe some action is required, it will be done. So I think that, you know, the type of radar and type of systems that they're going to put now, that will be a fairly advanced what we have with us. And it will be, as I said, is online.
It will be uploaded onto the satellites, and we have satellite systems, and it will be downlinked to a headquarter where 24/7 the area is mined, the Indian Ocean Fusion Center.
Right.
In fact, now we have, I believe, 36 countries who are giving the data of their white shipping, the merchant shipping.
Sure.
So I think there is a security concern as well here.
Right. Ambassador?
Well, I'll take off from where the Admiral left, relating to the security concerns. You know, China has been developing its so-called string of pearls, which is a whole set of ports from the Chinese mainland going right up to Djibouti. And this has involved the development by the Chinese of certain ports in our region, especially in Myanmar, in Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and of course the Gwadar port in Pakistan. So these definitely impinge on our security perceptions, and surely by setting up this surveillance radar system, the coastal surveillance radar system, we will be able to take care of our concerns to some extent.
Right.
And also the concerns of the littoral states of the Indian Ocean.
Sure. Professor, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Well, I think, Indian Ocean region is going to be one of the most contested in the coming years. And India needs a very robust mechanism to make sure that it has the kind of maritime domain awareness and that was perhaps we needed both for countering state as well as non-state threats that are going to emerge and that are emerging. So I think it is in that context that this system would bring great dividends to India, and one hopes that with the sense of partnership that India has developed with many of these countries, we would be able to generate a region, and we would be able to make a case for partnership with these countries that perhaps augurs well for the stability of the Indian Ocean region in the coming years.
All right. On that note, then, we'll call it a wrap on this edition of India's World. I'd like to thank all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. We'd like to hear from you as well. Do share your feedback with us. Our email ID is indiasworld.feedback@gmail.com. You can also tweet to us using our Twitter handles at FRP09 and at Rajya Sabha TV. That's it on this edition of India's World. See you again next time.